would like to invite Professor Kanan.
Thank you, Arvind. Can you all hear me?
Yeah, you are audible.
Okay. First of all, I want to congratulate the Tata Institute of Social Sciences, Hyderabad, as well as the National Institute of Rural Development, PR, Hyderabad. Start my video. Okay. For arranging this webinar with such a large number of people participating in it. Well, the time I have, around 15 minutes, I will try and flag a few issues, including the one Arvind mentioned on the question of social security. I wish the government of India, both the current government, as well as the earlier UPA governments, I wish they had paid some attention, serious attention, to the number of reports submitted by the National Commission for Enterprises in the Unorganized Sector, or what's called NCEUS. Most of the issues that we are facing today, including the lack of an identity problem for the migrant workers, would have been solved if the recommendations of that commission had been accepted. For example, we had suggested as part of the social security package and identification and registration system, establishment of workers' welfare centers in every panchayat and every municipal ward. If that workers' facilitation centers were to be established, we would have got an immediate connection with the migrant workers who wanted to leave, who would like to stay on, who would like to get the benefits that the government would like to give it to them, and so on and so forth, rather than letting them run shelter on the main road, walking hundreds of kilometers. A heartbreaking scene that modern, such a modern democratic country like India had to witness. My earlier speakers have already flagged the number of people involved, since your whole webinar is on the informal workers, isn't it? And informal workers form the overwhelming majority of workers in this country. Of course, depending upon how rigorously you use the definition, around 80% of them are in the informal sector and another 10% in the formal sector, so it makes around 90. But if you do a rigorous application of criteria, you might get 96%, as Professor Reddy Srivastava said. I have argued in my paper, which I wrote in the EPW Engage on April 4, that protecting the poor and vulnerable, including the informal workers, is like protecting the macroeconomy. This is not a new realization, it's a realization that we spelled out very clearly and analytically in our final report, in the final report of the NCEUS. And I wish those of you students who are listening to this webinar, go back to that report called The Challenge of Employment in India, an Informal Economy Perspective, published by the Academic Foundation, where we labor to argue that what should be the central objective of a developing country like India is employment-centered growth, not growth for itself, nor growth for its own sake, and take employment as a derivative of the growth that you are pursuing. That's a central point, and I hope in the future analysis of our macroeconomic situation and prospects, this aspect has already been championed by Amartya Sen, people like Amartya Sen, Joseph Stiglitz, and a whole range of commissions and committees. Would be, and Deepak Nayar, for example, would be taken very seriously. The second issue that I want to flag here as immediate measures to be taken to provide some relief to the informal sector workers as well as informal workers in the formal sector is the question of food and cash. Food is important, and although the government of India has announced 5 kg per capita for 1 month or 2 months, that is not enough. It has to cover all the households who need it, even whether or not you have a ration card or not. So the first point is to, in a situation like this, you should not make the ration card as an entitlement issue and provide for all those who need that, a universal scheme. And I'm sure there will be self-selection, and a lot of people like us who can afford will not go and stand in the queue for ration. The second one I want to point out is an immediate cash benefit. Some state governments, or a number of state governments, have provided, ranging from a very small amount, 1,000 rupees, to 5,000, 6,000 rupees. But there is no national uniform in there. It is sad to see that the government of India has been quite timid in its response, giving only 500 rupees, which is around less than 2 days' wages, to the accounts of the women in the Jan Dhan, although that accounting system is an interesting window for providing more cash transfers. So we should also advocate, while being academics and analysts, that immediate relief should be given both in terms of food and in terms of cash. The third one I want to talk to you about is, I have flagged that in my second article published in the Hindu Business Line on April 9 in the e-paper, as well as April 14 in their print version, that the government of India's response, macroeconomic response, has been quite a timid one. The 1.7 lakh crores is actually not 0.9% of the GDP, but only 0.5% of the GDP. If you discount the existing budgetary allocations which they have played around with, contrast that with 10% in the USA, 14 to 17% in UK, and similar measures, even in non-poor countries, because they know that there is a simultaneous collapse, a simultaneous compression of both demand and supply during the period of lockdown. And that can hurt not just the poor. Of course, poor will die of hunger. The other may escape, but they will also suffer. So it is in the interest of the government to introduce extraordinary measures in these extraordinary times. And I have argued in that very short paper that it is feasible for the government of India to mobilize an amount for intervention equivalent to 10% of our GDP, and that's around 20 lakh crores of rupees. That will give some basis to prevent a total collapse of demand in the economy and revive supply when lockdown restrictions are taken out. Inter alia, it will also help the informal workers in terms of restoring their work opportunities. If you don't do this, then the impact on the economy from an informal employment perspective, I have calculated, is that we are now losing, or not we, the informal workers as a whole, around 410 million of them, are losing a monthly wage of 3.5 lakh crores of rupees. And if you multiply that for 12 months, I hope it won't last for 12 months, it will be around 21% of the GDP. And that's their share of wages in the national income. It's only just 1/5 for the informal workers, which constitute 90%. So wage, while it is an income for individuals, especially for poor individuals and families, for survival, wage is a key variable in restoring the aggregate demand in the economy. So we should impress upon the policy makers, if such impression is required, that giving them an amount that is at least equal to, if not more than, their low wage is like protecting the economy. But when it comes to the measures to reduce vulnerability, as Arvind suggested that I speak on social security, I look at social security along the lines of the NCUS, because it looked at it in a larger framework, not just giving pensions or just a health security. We said there should be three major components in a nationwide minimum social security. One is you should have a minimum national floor wage, below which no state should set up a wage. So it's like a net, safety net, if you want to call it, going by the World Bank name. So that there is a non-statutory national minimum wage, but it's a pitiable wage. It has now been increased from 182 rupees to around 200. What is required, according to an expert committee constituted by this government, including experts loaned from ILO, is at least 375 rupees as national minimum floor wage for an Indian worker. Now, if we look at, if we hear about 375, we would almost wonder how can anybody even live with 375. But the fact is that this biologically determined 375 rupees is not being realized by the workers in India. I have estimated with the help of my collaborator that if you take the working class, workers as a whole in this country, 60% of our workers, a good percentage, a much higher percentage among women, do not get a wage, average wage of 375. 60% of the Indian workers do not get as 375 rupees a day as of 2017 and 18. This is more so for casual workers than regular workers. But even if you are lucky to be a regular worker, you are 52% of them don't get this wage. And even if you are a self-employed, and most of our self-employed is survival self-employed, the manual shop owners, the auto rickshaw drivers, the street vendors, you know, the chikan workers, the, you know, DD rollers, the handloom weavers, you can name any. 52% of them also don't earn an average of 375. So this 60% of the workers don't get a wage of 375 is a shame. Therefore, when we talk about medium and long-term measures, I think we should put all the weight of our intellectual analysis and advocacy that at least this minimum wage be declared as statutory for the toiling poor in India. Then there are the other social security measures. Some states like Kerala, Tamil Nadu, to some extent Himachal Pradesh, to some extent Punjab, they have over a period of time been giving a reasonable amount as old age pension. In Kerala, especially, there is this institution called Workers' Welfare Fund. There are about 32 to 35 workers' welfare funds for different segments of workers. And I'm happy to say that in recent times, when the corona crisis is going on, some of the welfare funds from their own resources have started paying ex gratia amount to their members. So it's another safety valve. So informal sectors need not be informal in terms of protecting them from crisis, if only the state could help them to establish autonomous welfare funds and welfare boards so that their members' needs could be taken into account. In other states, there are welfare funds for particular, for selected workers, including construction workers, but not the coverage, as I have said, in Kerala. The other immediate thing about social security has to do with vulnerability related social security, and that's what we now find among the 50 to 60 million of our migrant workers, because they want to go back to their village. They have no place because they are being evicted from the place of stay because they are not able to pay rent. Then they have no wage, and also they are concerned about their family members. Now I must say that I am now located in Kerala, that Kerala government has set an example in this. The Chief Minister described all the migrant workers from day one onwards as guest workers, underlying the fact that these migrant workers are doing us, the receiving state, a favor through their labor. So he said all those workers who would like to stay in Kerala will be protected. Now 19,000 camps are sheltering around 3.5 lakh migrant workers. There are more than that because some of them have already gone, and many of them have their own places of residence here because they are taken care of by the employers. But in these camps, with the help of the civil society, they are helped to prepare their own food if they want. They are being helped to find some employment in the place where they stay by engaging in horticulture, games, visit of health workers. Mobile health hospitals has been set up, and those who go and check them. So giving them a treatment that is more or less equivalent to a worker who is a domicile in this state. So social security is not just a long-term one of pensions and health insurance, but also the ability of a system, a state-led system, to protect them whenever they are in a very vulnerable situation. I have several other this thing, but I will not take too much of the time. I will add one more couple of points. One is the importance of having a public health system, publicly funded health system. Now, one of the Kerala's ability to tame the coronavirus spread is due to the coordinated work of the public health institutions, right from the primary health center in the panchayat to the district hospital, to the district level. In between, you have the community health centers, you have taluk hospitals, but it is the public health system that is called upon to face and fight the crisis, not the corporate private health institution. In fact, they are only talking. None of them have even offered to open up their hospitals for treatment, except now the government here has said that in case we want, we will summon all the facilities of the private institutions, including the beds, but that is in an extreme emergency. So the importance of a public health care system is to be noted, along with the Panchayat Raj system, which has its own funds given from the state to the panchayats, and the funds that they mobilize because they are working in local areas and people know each other, they are able to raise funds from the civil society. So it is because of the civil society's organization's active involvement that the Kerala government is today able to run 3,000 community kitchens throughout the length and breadth of Kerala. The community kitchens were started from the fourth day of the announcement because the execution was given to the panchayats and voluntary organizations. I think we have a major task ahead. I'm not going to repeat the macroeconomic losses that might be there after the lockdown is over, or if the partial lockdown continues. But as our earlier speakers underlined, we are living in extraordinary times of crisis. And this extraordinary times of crisis call for extraordinary measures. And the only institution that can take extraordinary measures is the national state, along with the cooperation of the regional states, which is in our parlance state governments. And that will be a really cooperative federalism. Cooperative federalism is not one when UDLE gives instructions and the states have to cough up money to spend for all schemes and the relief works. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Kannan, for providing us different inputs how we can restore the social security measures for informal sector work.